गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम। Okay students, in the last class we discussed about the introduction to compiler. We have seen the definition of compiler, and also we have seen the definition of interpreter and basic difference between the compiler and the interpreter we have seen. Also I have told about the principles of the compiler. Okay, so now in today's class we will see the structure of a compiler. Okay, according to the principles, we have noticed that the first principle is that the compiler must preserve the meaning of the program, whatever has been compiled. So it should never change the task to be performed. And the second principle is that there should be some improvement in your program after compiling. So in the structure of a compiler, we need to have some model where it will be simplified. Means you cannot have everything in one stage. Always the modularization is very important. So here also in the compiler also we have such phases, stages we have, and basically we divide into two phases, say front end and back end. Front end is very much associated with the source language program, and it is dependent on the source language program. Similarly, back end focuses on mapping the programs onto the target machine, and back end is dependent on the target machine. So we will be dealing with the particular machine in the back end. We will be taking the architecture with respect to that particular machine, and all the instruction set and everything goes with that particular machine. Okay, so this division is very important, because front end deals with something called analysis, and back end deals with something called synthesis. The names are given like this because analysis is basically how you analyze your code, and then how do you get some form which is very convenient for the back end. So that's what we try to do in the front end. So we need a lot of analysis in the front end. Similarly, in the back end, it is towards creation of the new kind of code. Therefore, the synthesis happens over there. We will be generating the code with respect to a particular target machine. Therefore, we call it as synthesis. Okay, so definitely there is some outcome from the front end, and that should be taken as an input to the back end. Therefore, that we call it as intermediate representation. So as you all know now, front end is dependent on the source language, and the back end is dependent on the target machine. So this IR, whatever we are going to create, which is the outcome of the front end, this should be independent, so that this can be used for many compilers, means for any source language, for any target machine we should be able to use. Only this is independent, whereas the front end and the back end are dependent on the source language and the target language. Okay, sometimes it is required to retarget also. That is because whatever compiler you have used, so that may be suitable for a particular machine. That's it. So it may not be suitable for running in another machine or a new machine. Therefore, we call it as that procedure. We call it as retargeting, where we will have to map onto a different target machine, and then definitely the backend should deal with a different machine. So we will have to take care of that. Okay, so that process is known as retargeting. So basically, this particular diagram shows a two-phase compiler, but later you will see that two-phase is not sufficient. So we will have to go with more phases. So we'll see that. So next is the three-phase compiler. Yeah. Yes.
Ma'am, that intermediate representation which you told us called assembly language, no, ma'am?
Yes, it is something related to assembly language, but not exactly, because in the intermediate representation itself, we have lot of forms. We have graphical form, we have linear code. We will be using some temporary variables and we will write the list of statements that is possible. So there are many forms. Okay, so that itself is one unit, means one chapter. So there we'll be dealing with all forms. But I will be telling a very simple form, maybe at the end of the class I will cover that. So intermediate representation is independent, so you can use any form. Sometimes we feel like using the graph itself as a intermediate representation. Sometimes we go with the linear code. Okay, so there are many forms. Okay, yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, so now, yes.
Can you repeat what you told about the synthesis? You said something.
I will be covering in the next in the next slide also same thing I'm going to do, okay, because I'm simply expanding each and everything, so you'll get an idea later. Synthesis,
yes,
about the creation of code I have told, but how it is done, what are the different phases also I will deal. Okay, so means slowly I am expanding. First I told about the two phase, now I am telling about the three phase, and then how it in each phase how it happens also I'm going to tell. Okay, so by the end of the class you will have some idea. Okay, yes. So let us see what is the requirement for one more phase here. So in the previous slide you saw there are only two phases, the front end and the back end, and we just took the intermediate representation. Okay, that's it. But one more phase is required, so we will add one middle section also, that is known as optimizer. So this optimizer is required to optimize the code, and then that the efficient code can be given to the back end. This is essential. Why? Because see, whatever you want to do, you can do it at this stage itself. So if you want to improve the efficiency, maybe you can try more here, so that it is independent of any language, and this you are going to give it to the back end, and there it becomes very convenient and easy. So that's why we use one optimizer, or actually it is not one optimizer, maybe I will show in the next slide. So there are series of optimization techniques used here to improve the intermediate representation code itself, so that the efficient code will be taken as an input to the backend. So optimizer is also required for the IR program. At each level it takes and then optimizes and give it to the next level, and that will be taken as an input, and it improves some code, and then the final code will be taken into the backend. So this leads to the three-phase compiler. Okay, but this is also not sufficient. We'll expand more. So this is the general structure of a typical compiler. So you can observe that the three phase has been elaborated here, the front end, the optimizer, and the back end. So in the front end, we will be having the first phase, which is known as the scanning, or we will be using some tool called scanners or scanner generators. So so that is the first stage, which we also call it as lexical analysis. So scanner is also known as lexical analysis phase, and also sometimes some authors call it as linear analysis, because we read our program, we scan our program from top to bottom, left to right, in that sequence only we read always. That is also known as linear analysis. So that is the first phase. So after the linear analysis, the output, whatever we are going to get, which I'm going to tell later, so that will be taken as an input to the next phase, which is the parser. So this parser, in this particular phase, what we do is we perform the syntax analysis. Okay, so this is parsing, as well as it is known as syntax analysis. So this deals with the syntax, and then if any error is there, it will check. Here also in the lexical analysis phase also, if any error is there, it will give. And each phase, it gives some errors. So this particular infrastructure, what I'm saying here is, what we are using here is, it actually maintains the data structures, whatever is required, and also it deals with the detection. So it gives, okay, in this particular line, this particular error is there. So every phase, the errors are found for the entire program, and it will give the appropriate message for that. So that's why everything, all the phases are connected with this infrastructure, because this infrastructure totally, it has all like data structures or some routines which need to be used to give appropriate messages. All these will be used in the infrastructure. So so parsing, after the parsing, what happens is we will be getting something called a parse tree or the syntax tree, so which will check the syntax, and if it is successful, then it will generate the tree with respect to that. And we have lot of techniques here also, like top down parsing and bottom up parsing. So we will deal with that, and then finally we will get the output. So that is fed into the next level. So next level is here, it is given as elaboration, but most of the authors call it as semantic analysis phase. Okay, semantic analysis phase. So what happens here, in the parsing step or in the syntax analysis step, it only checks the syntax. It is not checking the meaning. Means you take some A is equal to B plus C. A is equal to B plus C, syntactically it is correct. So there is no problem. So it says, yes, it is correct. But when it comes to the next phase, which is known as semantic analysis phase, so what kind of operation you are doing, on what data, what is the type, what is the value related to that, all that have to be checked in this phase. That is the semantic analysis phase. So whatever operation we are doing, whether it is legal to do it, it will check. Or if you are assigning something to the LHS variable, is it legal to use like that? Can I assign something in the RHS to the LHS where you have declared some data type? And if you are trying to do some, suppose you want to perform arithmetic operation, and then you are taking the string data type and you want to perform arithmetic operation. So that is not valid. So like this, it will check the meaning. It will check the meaning. And one of the important tasks covered in this phase is the type checking. So whether it makes sense to have the operation particularly in each statement, it will check. And then, so it will create another tree here, or some intermediate result it will create. And so that is only taken as the output here, and that only we call it as intermediate representation. So by the end of the semantic analysis, so we have finished our front end, where we have done lexical analysis, syntax analysis, and semantic analysis. And by now, we have got the intermediate representation in some form. In some form, there are many forms. Okay, so that form is taken as an input for the next phase, that is the second phase. So the second phase is about the optimization. As you all know, optimization is to improve the code, that is the efficiency should be improved. Maybe you would have used some variables which are not essential, so that is there still. Maybe you can remove that, like a dead code elimination can be done. And sometimes what happens, you would have put some statement inside the loop which is not essential, because inside the loop there is no effect of that statement. It is not changing any value. Maybe you would have done some mistake. Those things have to be taken care now, and all these will be done in the optimization. As you observe here, optimization 1, optimization 2, etc., etc., optimization n. So why I need so many optimizations? Because there is not only one strategy used for the optimization. So we can use a series of optimization techniques. And finally, at the lower end, means I have the higher end here. So I will take whatever is coming from semantic analysis phase, we just take it as an input, and then we apply some technique here. Okay, that output we take, and another technique we can apply, and so on. Finally, by the end of the optimization N, you will be able to get a very optimized code. So that will be a very convenient form which can be used as an input for backend, because most of our work is done here, and therefore the backend will be easy. So whatever may be the machine, anyway, you'll have to improve the code, because one of the principle of compiler says that the code has to be improved in some way. So that's what we are doing here. And it is not required that only here we are going to do. Definitely here also it can be improved. Many authors actually in this book, it is like this. In some books, if you refer or some internet resource, if you see, here also some code optimization is done. Okay, so that is okay, because when you check, maybe if you feel that okay, the order can be changed without affecting the result, yes, you can do so. So here also some kind of optimization can be done, but the main optimization is very much essential here, because before you select the instruction, before you schedule something, before you allocate the register, you will have to do the optimization. So optimization is done in the intermediate representation phase. So it is improved now, and that is fed into the backend. Now coming to the backend, in the backend, we know that it is depending on the target machine. So definitely all these instructions are with respect to that particular machine only. Because as you see, whenever you take a particular machine, maybe if you have learned some assembly language programming, you'll have some idea. Different machines will have different instruction set, a different architecture, different facilities in the architecture, and different registers, name of the register, size of the registers, addressing modes, data size, everything may differ. Okay, so that's what we are dealing with now. So this is to a particular target machine, and first thing is we are going to select the instructions. So what is that I am trying to do? Whether I am doing arithmetic operation, whether my input should be there in the register or memory location. So I have to bring it into the register. Then how do I bring that? So I will have to use some instruction over there. So either I have to go with the move instruction, or sometimes we can go with the load instruction. So definitely move instruction and load instruction, they take different number of bytes. Okay, so we will have to select the instruction. So what is it? What is the convenient way? What is the instruction to be selected so that can be done? Similarly, any operation, suppose I want to work with the floating point numbers, then accordingly I will be selecting the instruction. So suppose I want to multiply two numbers which are floating point numbers, accordingly I'll be selecting the instruction. So mult, maybe some instruction opcode will be there. So with respect to that, it will be selected. So similarly, I will have to store the result somewhere in some memory location. Then I'll be using some instructions say store. Something like this, we will have to select the instructions with respect to the particular architecture. In our discussion, in our syllabus, what we are going to do is, we are not going to take any particular machine. We are only going to take one abstract model or abstract machine, only the general notations will be using, okay? And general addressing modes we are going to use. So with respect to that only we are going to have, because there are a lot of machines, we can't take all examples. Therefore, one abstract model we are going to have, and with respect to that only we are going to teach. Okay, so that is the first step, that is the instruction selection. So that is based on whatever intermediate representation you have created. Now you know what is the sequence of operations to be done, and that is taken, and you have selected the instructions. And then the instruction scheduling. Sometimes what happens, we will have to schedule the instruction in such a way that our operation also should be efficient. We should get the desired result, and also it should be efficient in every way. Like when I want to use registers effectively, then maybe I need to reorder sometimes in my code. Okay, without affecting the results. If it is going to affect the results, definitely we can't do that. But some kind of analysis is done here also for the instruction scheduling, which instruction should be executed first, which should be next, and so on. So all that will be done in the instruction scheduling. And then coming to the register allocation, as I have already mentioned, if it is a real machine, then definitely we will have the limited number of registers. Okay, so we have to use the registers very effectively. So we will have to see, and maybe sometimes what happens, we have to go back and then change, and then we have to reallocate. All that can happen. So that's why I told in this level also some kind of optimization is done to improve the efficiency. Okay, so finally what I am looking forward is I have to use less number of cycles. Okay, and if possible, less number of bytes also. Okay, so that's what we try here, and then finally we get the target code. So this part is entirely with respect to the target code. So the first thing is the instruction selection. You have a lot of instructions. You will have to select the instructions based on your sequence of operations, which has been already created in the IR. And then after selecting also, sometimes you'll have to schedule, okay, which should be executed first, which should be executed next, and so on. And after that, we will be going with the register allocation, because to deal with our data, definitely it has to be either in the memory or in the register. So we will have to use some temporary registers for our operation, and we select that, and we want to use less number of registers, that is more effective. Okay, so like this we can have the entire structure of our compiler, where we are taking here the source program. It may be some C language program or C++ or Java, whatever, and then finally we got some executable code in that particular target machine. Okay, so that is about the overall structure of the compiler. So, yes.
When we write directly in the assembly language code, how does this work? Because we will already be choosing the registers as well, and even the instructions like move and load, that also we only will be choosing, unlike in the regular C program codes.
Yes.
So how?
Okay, as because you have raised, I will tell. See, compiler is basically to convert from source language program to the target language program, and my source language is what it is, some high level language only. Okay, but what you are saying is, if you are writing your code already in the assembly language program, so that we use another translator called assembler. Okay, for that we'll be using something called assembler, where the assembler is what it will take the input as assembly language program, and then it will create a target code. Okay, so that is a different translator. So that is also one kind of system software which will take assembly language code as an input, and then it will create the target. So actually now why I am telling this, recent compilers, it will directly give the target code. But if you go back and see very old compilers, maybe they would have adopted even the assembler as one of the phase, because it cannot be done, means every operation cannot be done so easily. That's why for those old languages and old compilers, they also may used to have the assembler as one of the translator, and also something called relocatable code. All those were there. But nowadays, whatever compilers we are having, it doesn't need any supportive software, because it can handle itself. Actually, if you refer the history, you will realize that you should use many system softwares. Actually, the loaders are required, then the linkers are required, and the languages like Pascal or Fortran, if at all you use those compilers, would have shown the results in phases. Like, okay, every stage, okay, this is pass one compilation, pass two compilation, and so on. But now we don't have that kind of compilers. We have a very good compilers which can manage everything. You don't need to have another system software to link your code or link your libraries. It can do itself. Okay. Similarly, for loading, you would have saved somewhere, and then you want to load it into your main memory. For that also, we used to have another system software. So those things are not required nowadays, because it can manage itself. Okay, so what the typical compiler I am telling is the recent ones, where we use all possibilities in the compiler itself. Yes?
A relocatable code is like, now also we use the term, no ma'am? Like it's yes, just yes. Okay ma'am, yes ma'am.
Yes, now also we need, because suppose you have some way, you have saved somewhere, maybe due to the lack of memory, you would have done that. So you will have to relocate it. Okay, means from where you want to execute, maybe you will have to relocate, and from there only you can do. So that can be used at any time. Yes.
A relocatable code is just a term where we say that the code is with respect to a certain number of difference, like same page, something in a page, and then we are having some code in it. We won't be actually relocating. We are just using the term for making a reference, no ma'am, to extract or to access a particular data or instruction in a page or something.
Yes.
like
yes,
that
of course. Yeah, yes, but most of the time what we assume is it is actually virtual. So whatever we are assuming, suppose I say 8000 is the address, means it is only my imagination that 8000 is the memory location, but we don't know where actually physical memory location till we find, we don't know where it is allocated, isn't it? But we are imagining, okay, it, like how we allocate array, okay, it starts from 0, then the next location is some 2, whatever. So like that we are imagining, you know, that all is like abstract only. It's only that we are having the logical addressing, that's all. We are not taking care of the physical addressing. So if you take care of the physical addressing, then actual memory location you'll be using. The physical address only you'll be using. But most of our discussions will deal with only the logical addressing and only with the virtual. Okay. Yeah, what you are saying is very much correct. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, so the front end deals with the analysis phase, and then somebody asked about the synthesis. Is that clear? I don't know the name. Sorry. Synthesis, you were asking, no? Is that clear after completing that?
Synthesis is just the generation of the target language program,
yes,
after
yes.
We get intermediate representation. That
yes, yes,
enough,
yes.
Ma'am?
Yes, yes, yes.
Ma'am?
Okay,
ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, your target program is like only machine language or anything else, ma'am?
Which program? Target program. Yes, 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 yes. It is a machine code. It is an executable code.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. So front end deals with the analysis, where we read the source program and then we understand its structure and its meaning. Here only all the three phases you can see. We are reading the source program, that is scanning, and then we are understanding the structure, which is nothing but the syntax analysis. And then we also see the meaning, which is nothing but the semantic analysis. So these are the three things that are covered in front end. Similarly, the back end is to generate equivalent target language program. So there should not be any deviation from the task. So whatever we are aiming to do it, that has to be done in the target machine, and it should be capable also. So definitely it should be capable of having all the instructions that are required for our operations. Okay, so there are some implications also. So definitely means the compiler must recognize legal programs and complain about illegal ones. In the sense, any errors are there, definitely it has to find it. Must generate the correct code. Definitely the correctness is very important. And then must manage the storage of all the variables and data. Yes, that is required. And must agree with the operating system and the linker. So whatever you asked, I am putting that point here. So definitely the operating system and the linker on the target format should also be supported. And then some intermediate representation is required. And then front end maps source into IR, back end maps IR into target machine code. And then often we use multiple IRs because at each level we perform optimization. So starting from the higher level till the lower level in the later phases. So we start with the higher level, and the final level, what we call is the lower level, which is towards our target machine. So we get the instructions in such a way that it is very convenient to convert into the target machine code.
Ma'am, will that the input will be some high level programming language, which is some English or something like that? No, ma'am.
No, not English. Definitely it is a programming language.
Like I mean to say int a, some for loop and something. So the output, the target code, will it be in binary format or will it be in the same like
yes,
int?
Yes, it should be. Okay, so because you're asking, I'm clarifying this once again. See, when I say instruction set, it is not just instruction set. For every, like for move, I have some code. I don't know, maybe you have not worked, I think, in the lab. Did you have COA lab? I think you didn't have the lab, right? Okay, so for every instruction, for every operation, there will be
computer
some
computer architecture.
Yeah, so
we learned about the instructions.
Oh, is it? Okay. So that is what is the binary code, no? So whatever hexadecimal code or whatever code you are creating for every operation, for every addressing mode, with every data you're working on, so that itself is the binary code, right? So finally, you are getting the binary code. That's what we are finding here also. Okay, means when I say move, means it is not just move. It has an equivalent code for it. We call it as opcode or operation code. or sometimes we call it as mnemonics. Okay, yes, so that code only we can represent in binary form. So when I say instruction set or instruction sequence, that is what I meant. Okay, finally it is an executable code. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so overview of a translation. So suppose if I take some source program. So source program means some language program you have taken, which is nothing but a character stream. Stream of characters you have got, and that will be given as an input to the scanner in the first phase, which is nothing but the front end. And then what this scanner will do? It will read your character stream one by one, and then it will create the sequence of tokens. It will create the sequence of tokens. Suppose I take some particular statement, say some expression. Okay, so A is equal to B plus C, suppose. So A is one variable name, equals is an operator, B is another variable name, and C is another variable name, and a plus is an arithmetic operator which stands for addition. So like this, it will have to create the sequence of tokens. So what it will do then? So it will actually classify as some operators and punctuations like this. It will, because you'll be using these symbols in your program, source program. So open braces, close, and then any square brackets if you have used, and then not symbol. So whatever you use, everything it will just classify it as operators and punctuation marks, comma, semicolon, colon, all that. And then also whatever keywords you want to have, yes, you can list all the keywords. There are many, okay? I have listed only few. Similarly, identifiers means whatever variable names you use for the variables as well as the function names. So that will be the identifier. I hope you have learned the how to write the regular expression for identifier in TOC, and also how to write the transition diagram for recognizing identifier. I think you would have practiced. I don't know. Anyway, we are going to cover it in the next chapter, so don't worry. So identifiers are the variable names or the function names or actual name, whatever you want to take. And also there can be constants like integer constant, floating point number, string constant, character constant, all that also can be there. So it will classify like this. So later I will take one example to show this. So what is a token then? Token is nothing but a character stream which will have some type over there. So you are categorizing whether it is an operator, whether it is a keyword, whether it is an identifier, whether it is a constant. So like this you are classifying. And also you can give some names for these. So if the name of the identifier is say A, so I can use some notation, say ID comma A. So this is classified as ID, and the name of that ID is what? A. Similarly, if it is a plus operator, I can give the category as arithmetic operator, and it is a plus, PLUS. So some compilers do this. Anyway, this will be dealt in the next chapter. So like this, we can have the sequence of tokens. Okay, so here also we are saying about how the scanning is done. So it will read your source program and it will classify it as the sequence of tokens. And what are the concepts that are required here? The regular expressions, because to represent any pattern, whether it is a keyword, whether it is an identifier, whether it is an operator, for whatever, you need some form to represent, and we are using the regular expressions. And to show the transitions, like when you read an input, how the transition takes place from one state to the other state, so that also we need to do. Because if you have to take a pattern and only when it reaches the final state, you say that it is recognized. If it is in the non-final state, then it is not recognized. In the last class, I told one example. Suppose I want to recognize sum as my identifier. So first state I will read S, then in the next state I will read U, and in the next state I will read M, and then I will reach the final state. Suppose I want to recognize if. So in the first state I will read I, I'll go to the next state, and then after reading F, I'll go to the final state. And I say that it is the keyword which is if. So like this, we will be recognizing. Therefore, we use this DFA and NFA. And the last one is the tool itself. So you don't have to develop everything on your own. So there is a tool used called Lex. This is particularly for C language program. and if you use this tool, it will give whether something is recognized or not. But in this tool, you'll be using the concept of regular expressions, and you will have to write the regular expression and you will have to give the action. So it will give the proper message according to that. So this Lex we are going to use in the lab. So we will have a more discussion on this in the lab itself. Okay. So Lex is a tool. It is a tool for C language, and it performs a scanning or lexical analysis. So coming to the next phase is the parser, which is also known as a syntax analysis. So what it does here is it will compare the syntax with the standard syntax. Means whatever program I have written, my syntax it will compare with the standard syntax, and that standard syntax is represented using the context-free grammar. Okay, so that context-free grammar means you would have written the grammar maybe for small things you would have written. Right, in the TOC. And now we will write a full-fledged context-free grammar for every construct. Means if I have to show some declaration, yes, this is a declaration statement. This is an arithmetic expression. This is a logical expression. This is a printf statement. So this is the block used for the if-else. This is the block used for the for loop. This is the block used for the while loop. So like this, we will have to write the context-free grammar for everything, for all the language constructs. And whatever we write in our code, so that it will compare with the standard context-free grammar. And for that, we do two types of parsing, top-down parsing and the bottom-up parsing. And by the end of the parsing, you'll know that whether our syntax is correct or not. If it is not correct, then it will say error is there. And if it is correct, then it will be error free and the parsing will be successful. So what it is going to do finally, it is going to create a tree called the syntax tree. Maybe in TOC, you would have learned a derivation tree. Or maybe they would have introduced this name also, parse tree, something like that. So that's what we are going to build in the parsing step. So it will create the syntax tree. So the concepts used are the context-free grammar, and this Backus Naur form we are not going to use. This is another form of grammar, so that we are not going to use. Similarly, grammar analysis algorithms also we are not going to use. So in our discussion, in our syllabus, we are going to have the context-free grammar. So that we are going to have, and all kind of derivations we are going to have, all kind of parsings we are going to have. So some of the parsing techniques which we have in our syllabus is LL parsing, LR, SLR, LALR parses. So these are some types of parses. So that we are going to have it in the chapter 3. So at that time we will deal with that. And here also for parsing we have the tool, this YARC is one tool we used for the parsing step. YARC stands for at another compiler. This is also meant for C language. So it checks whether a particular statement is syntactically correct or not. So it verifies that, and it does the parsing, and then it gives the corresponding output. And also remember that whatever input is going to the parser is from the scanner. So by now we have got all the tokens in the sequence, and those tokens only we are taking in that sequence in the parsing, and we are checking whether that sequence is proper or not. So that's what we are checking. So finally we get that syntactical structure, which is a parse tree or the syntax tree, and that will be taken as the input for the next analysis, which is the semantic analysis. Okay. So semantic analysis deals with the meaning because I mentioned the parser can only take care of the syntax. It cannot take care of the meaning. Okay, so therefore we use semantic analysis also. Here we use some routines. It will check the type for every data variable. It will check whether it is proper or not. When you give an expression, it will check whether this is a feasible operation or not, whether it is valid or not, whether it is legal to use it or not. So those things will be checked here in the semantic analysis phase. And here also it will create some kind of structure. In between, it will use something called abstract syntax tree, where in the parser, we will have the entire structure, every stage of derivation, we will be showing. But that in the abstract syntax tree, we can only show how the operators have been used and not every level of derivation. Okay, that maybe you'll understand when we teach that particular chapter. So that is what happens in the semantic analysis phase. So we will be using something called syntax directed translation. I will be using some kind of grammars, say attribute grammars, and finally we are going to get the intermediate representation as an output. Okay, so intermediate representation we are going to get, and that will be fed to the next level, that is the optimizer. Okay, optimizer is it has lot of techniques for optimizing, like constant folding is one technique, then dead code elimination is one technique. Like this, we have loop to optimization is one technique. So like this, we have lot of optimization techniques at various levels. We will do the optimization, which also helps in register allocation. Because I told you, know, in the backend also some kind of optimization is done so that the number of registers used should be less, and also the code scheduling should be convenient and it should be efficient. So optimization is done in the IR code, and then finally we go with the code generator. So code generator is basically all those things you can take. Code generator includes everything like instruction selection, instruction scheduling, as well as the register allocation. So finally we are going to get the target machine code, okay, and that is the executable code. So now the optimization, it can be used here also before the code generation, and as a part of code generation also it can be used. So this is so I told about the structure. Yeah,
ma'am, this optimization is not related to the space and time complexity.
Definitely, indirectly it means that, okay, because optimization, why we are doing optimization? To create a code in such a way that it takes less time. Definitely it matters. Means I told you, know, that the number of cycles should be reduced, means number of cycles in the sense it is affecting the time. Because see, when I use move instruction, I use different number of bytes. When I use load instruction, I use different number of bytes. And similarly, the number of cycles required for move instruction may be lesser than the number of cycles required for load instruction, for store instruction. So the number of cycles, the number of bytes, everything matters. So indirectly you are doing that only. You are calculating the cost, and you are calculating the time efficiency and space efficiency also. But nowadays,
changes, no, ma'am. Like we can sort an array in n square time and n log n time also. But we have written it in n. We have written it by selection sort, which is n squared. Mm-hmm. So will it optimize to n log n, or it is same as n squared? It will be n squared, no, ma'am.
You can optimize because the way we use data structures, that also matters. See, it depends upon the requirement. See, some compilers will be very fast, some compilers will be very slow. You would have noticed that, right? So definitely, if you want more optimization, you can increase the levels and then make it optimize. As you said, okay, sorting, if you want to use good, see, first of all, the thing is we will not use very weak data structures. Definitely, we won't go with the weak data structures, because there are a lot of things that have to be added in, like dynamically also some data should be updated. So we will not go with the static allocation always, although it exists. We most of the time we go with the dynamic allocation. And also even though I say compiler operations, everything is static, but at some point it is also essential to take care of this time efficiency and the space efficiency also. If not space efficiency, definitely the time efficiency, because the number of cycles are very important. That's where we go with the optimization. So whatever data structure you want to use, yes, you can select the optimized way of using the data structure, and the optimized algorithm also you can take. Definitely it is possible. So that depends upon your requirement. So what is your requirement? Accordingly, you can develop your scheme. Is that clear?
No, ma'am, the point I'm trying to say is if I'm coding it in n squared time and the output is in n log n time, the meaning has changed, ma'am.
Why the meaning has changed? Okay, see, sorting you want to do.
Same, ma'am, but the condition for the there are two rules, ma'am. The meaning should not be changed, And
see, meaning is not changing now also. See, what is the final output you want to get sorted, right? Suppose your problem is sorting, isn't it? Sorted array you are getting, then the meaning has not changed, isn't it? So meaning is not changed. Whatever you are getting the output, you are getting the same thing. See, just because you change the algorithm, it will not change the meaning. That is not the thing. So meaning means what I am expecting, what is my aim to get an output. That's what is the meaning I said. So semantically equivalent, when I say it is that if I want to sort in the ascending order, I get the elements in this ascending order only, not something else. That's what I meant. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, I want to sort, and if ma'am, it is searching, then it is wrong, isn't it? Yes.
Ma'am, if that is considered to be true, then if we proceed to various sorts like quicksort, bubble sort, merge sort, all will be running, taking the same time. But that does not happen actually, no, ma'am. The compiler cannot alter the actual code, but it can optimize wherever it can, because it cannot just change the lines in the code and then, yes, no, ma'am.
Yeah,
optimization.
See, optimization, why we are doing that is for our convenience only we are doing. It is not compulsory to apply all the techniques of optimization. That's why I have given a very random number optimization 1 to optimization n, isn't it? So if at all I want to really optimize with all the techniques, then only I will go with that. Otherwise it is optional. That is why the two-phase compiler as well as three-phase compiler exists. Why we look forward for the three-phase compiler? Because I have more options to optimize. If at all you are not doing it, it's okay, fine, no problem. Only thing is that it will take more time. That's it. So it is not compulsory to do everything, okay? So if at all, and don't compare only these kind of problems. See, what you are raising is some sorting problem. Maybe you have learned DAA, so you are analyzing with respect to the time complexity, with respect to N. So it is not just depending on N, okay? There are other parameters also. I need to maintain all my variables in my program. I need to perform the operation, whether, see, the same thing, A is equal to B plus C into D. If I have to do, I can give it as one step, isn't it? That is supported by C language, but it may not be supported in the assembly language. So accordingly, I will have to select the instructions. So that's what I'm telling. So how much ever is possible to optimize, you're going to optimize. It is not required that at every level, yes, you have to do it. We are not making that rule. Okay, it is left to you if you want to optimize. So it depends upon the compiler. So if you are developing, then you take care of all this. That's what I am trying to tell. Okay, all compilers may not be very fast also, isn't it? So it may not be fast. So it depends upon what is the core of it. What is that they have designed? It depends upon that. So that's why maybe some compilers are slow, some compilers are fast, isn't it? Is that clear? All this maybe when you go through your intermediate representation phase, no, there you will understand. So if we don't do the optimization, what is the effect you can see? Is that clear, students? I think it's time now. Maybe we'll continue in the next class, students. So I'm stopping here. Although I have told this tools I have already mentioned. So in the next class, maybe we can start with some example and all the translation steps we can see overview. So that we'll see. Okay, 2 more minutes are there. If you have any doubts, I don't know the last person who asked, then please tell your name. If it is not clarified, you can just wait. The last person, whoever asked the doubt, please tell your name. Is it Priya?
Yes, ma'am. The actual doubt was raised by Priyadarshan, ma'am.
Okay, okay. So, Priyadarshan, is that clear, Priyadarshan?
Yeah, fine, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, the thing is, we were telling, in case we take the selection sort, it will be having n square time complexity, and the quick sort will be n log n. And if we run the codes in the same compiler, we won't be noticing, but there is a difference in the time which takes to run the code. So the compiler, the typical compiler, whatever it does, optimization, it is like internal. We cannot just change it. So it's like the n square and n log n cannot be changed, but whatever the steps for the step optimization can be done. But the overall time complexity, which we generally tell by the number of loops run or whatever, that cannot be altered, no, ma'am. That was only Priyadarshan was asking, I guess.
Yes. Okay, now, okay, I got your point, what he was expecting. See, there are two things, students, in DAA you would have learned. So, the efficiency is based on two things. One is the compile time and the other one is the runtime. Maybe you are asking about the runtime. So, what you have learned is about the runtime only, that the number of steps, inside the loop, all that it is speaking about the runtime of your program, okay. What I am trying to say here is, during the compilation also the time can be reduced. See, for each phase, whatever we are doing, so this is actually the compile time, we call it as static time, and the execution time or the runtime, we call it as the dynamic time, because at that instant of time, what input you give based on that. See, I can write my program and it depends upon the input. And that input, if you are taking into consideration and then running it, and you are saying either O of n square or O of n log n, that is about the runtime and not about the compile time. Okay, I am clarifying once again. So what you are speaking about is about the runtime, and what I am speaking about is the compile time. Okay, so the compilation time also can be reduced. That's what we are trying to optimize. Okay, and of course it will affect in the runtime also, because internally it is doing some optimization, because it can be done by the compiler also. Like how it finds the errors, likewise it can also internally convert. Means what is happening by the end of the compilation, you would have got the executable code. So this executable code only we are going to use finally, right? So this executable code is also important. That is what we are trying to have the optimization here. And what you are saying is definitely it is the analytical feature you are telling, that is theoretically you are saying. If at all you want to see the exact execution time, yes, you can use a timer and then you can print it and see. Okay, for every execution, when the input changes, how it is going to affect in the execution time. But if at all you have to take both into consideration, the compilation time is important, because once you compile, you can run any number of times. But the execution time is definitely based on your input size. So that is based on your input size. Okay. So the input program is there and the input size is there. Both you need. Okay. Input program is that we are taking and then we are converting into the machine language code. That's what we are trying to do. Whereas what you are saying is it depends upon the input when you give dynamically. At the runtime only you will give. So this O of n square, O of n, what is this n then? N is nothing but the size of your input. Maybe the size of an array or something like that. Okay, so that is the runtime. So now I think you understood. If you have to calculate the total time, then it is the compilation time plus execution time. Okay, if you are concentrating only on the execution time, then it is depending on your input size. Definitely on the input size. Okay, your selection sort or whatever sort, no, that definitely depends upon your input size and each element in your input. And this is about the compilation. So execution code, if it is optimized, then the time taken also will be less. So that's what I'm trying to tell. Okay, so anyway, we'll see more about it later in the next few chapters. Okay, students, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.